Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I want to talk about a short history of programming languages and the environment in which they were developed, and furthermore, why we would want to study the concepts of programming languages. So first of all, let's start with programming languages, how they have been developed over the times. It is essential to understand that programming always happens within a context. The context being the computing machines that are available in a certain time. So let's get started. Programming started, some say, at the turn of the 1800s, eh? So the beginning of 1800s, there was the invention by Jacquard, the Jacquard's loom, which is a weaving machine that uses punch cards to program the patterns that the weaving machine would weave. Now, this was an interesting invention because the cards that were used by the machine were read out, and based on the information stored in the cards, the weaving machine produced certain patterns in the fabric. This is of course a very productive invention, because you could reuse the same set of cards to produce the same pattern over and over and over again. This does not need any manual intelligence, so to say, how to operate the weaving machine. Then later, Charles Babbage came, and some people say Charles Babbage is the father of computer science. Charles Babbage invented first the difference engine, and later he worked on the analytical engine. You could say that Charles Babbage is a typical computer scientist. He proposes a large project, then works tirelessly on it, and eventually failed. Then there is also Ada Lovelace, Countess of Lovelace. She is considered to be the first computer programmer. She had lots of conversation and discussion with Babbage. They communicated lots with each other. And she wrote articles about how to use the hypothetical analytical engine by Charles Babbage to solve certain numerical problems. And she wrote the first non-trivial computer program. The purple text you see is a link. If you click on it, you go to the Science and Industry Museum website. And here you can see more about this early history of programming. Here you see a nice picture of the cards that were used in Jacquard's loom. So you can check this out yourself later. So that was around 1800, Jacquard's loom, and then development of the difference engine and the analytical engine by Babbage. Now, a lot has happened in computing since the Second World War. The machines that are now displayed, the Z1, the ENIAC, and the ADVAC, are typical war machines, you could say. Z1 was built by Konrad Zuse in his home, but unfortunately it was destroyed during a bombing. So last October I went to the Technology Museum in Berlin to visit and I saw the Z1 machine, and I was very, very happy to see it. But only later I learned it was a replica and it was destroyed, so there does not exist. The real machine no longer exists. It was entirely mechanic. In contrast, on the Allied side, so to say, you had the development of the ENIAC and the ADVAC. These were huge machines, filled rooms, and were built out of vacuum tubes. Now, the ENIAC had to be operated using a plug board. So to change its operation, an operator would have to manually change the plugs to reconfigure the machine. The EDFAC is what people consider the first stored program machine. It means that the instructions that the machine executes are actually stored within the working memory of the machine. So there you could say the modern notion of a computer was first realized. Later, mainframes appeared. Now, mainframes you can understand as large machines typically filling up a room that were employed by governments and large organizations. The way you would interact with mainframes is by using punch cards, similar to Jacquard's loom. A punch card then contains the instructions of the machine. The machine reads in the punch card and it starts to operate. These machines operated in batches. So you would give it a set of punch cards. It would then read out what the program is that was encoded on the punch cards. It executes the program. Sometimes it works, sometimes it crashes, and it provides a printout. You can see the link to see someone's experience with how this worked back in the times. Now, later, mini computers appeared. And mini computers were called mini because they did not require a whole room to be installed in. They were of the size of, let's say, a refrigerator, so considerably smaller. So around this time, you also had the development of the Unix operating system, which later became very influential. This was all done on a mini computer. Then we have the era of personal computing. This is something that I have experienced myself. So personal computers make access to computing more widely available. And suddenly, more and more people started to use computers. In that time, you also had the emergence of graphical user interfaces, and there was a PC gaming industry that started to boom. Later, we had mobiles, and the internet started to become more and more widespread. The emergence of web browsers was happening. And finally, we are in the current state of the world. It is not yet known how to characterize these days, but maybe later we can do that. So this gives you an idea, roughly, of how, what kind of computing happened. As you can see, these war machines, Z1, ENIAC, and EDVAC, those were mechanical or vacuum tubes. They had to be replugged. So their programming really was very specialist. However, if you look at the later developments, nowadays everybody has access to multiple computing devices. So the environment in which you do computing also changes what you need from a programming language. So let's talk a little bit about that. So Z1 and ENIAC did not have a programming language, but the stored procedure computer EDFAC did. It made use of what is called assembly code. So these are numerical codes which encode what the operations are that the machine must execute. Now, after a while, it became clear that coding in assembly is a lot of work. So the need for a computer language arises. So in the era of mainframes, there were, among others, the languages Fortran and Algol. So Fortran stands for Formula Translator, and it was mainly used for numerical and scientific computing. Algol, algorithmic language, on the other hand, was a more general language that also was able to operate on multiple kinds of data. Later, when minicomputers appeared, there was also an expansion in what programming languages were available. And I do not list them all here, but this gives you an idea. So there is the C programming language, which was developed quite in tandem with the Unix operating system, by the way. And Prolog, you have the structured query language SQL, you have the meta language ML, and BASIC. BASIC also is an acronym that I always forget what it stands for. Then during the age of personal computing, again, many new languages appeared, which made the programming task in that environment more easier, so to say. So you had the development of C++ and Objective-C. I believe Objective-C was developed in the context of the next step. And you also have the languages Perl, Camel. Later on, in the internet age, there was an explosion of programming languages. So these might seem familiar to you. You have the personal homepage language, JavaScript as it is used in web browsers, the Python language, Ruby, Java, C#, etc., etc. Now, more recently, the number of languages only expand. So, to just give you a short idea of what there is now, F#, Clojure, Julia, TypeScript, Rust, etc., etc. So, let it be clear that the number of programming languages is increasing. So, the main question then arises, why would you use a different programming language under different circumstances? What are the commonalities between these programming languages? What are their differences? Moreover, given the fact that there are so many programming languages, is there not a way for you to understand what underneath most of them, so that whenever you want to use a new language, it is easier to get started and to learn a new language quicker? Well, for that, let's start with a definition of a programming language. Every programming language has this in common. A programming language is a formal language with a certain meaning. By formal language, I mean that the programming language, as you write programs in your programming language, these must be recognizable by a computer. Now, by certain meaning, I mean that the programs you write in a programming language are unambiguously meaning something. And what is that something? Well, it is describing an intention to perform computations. So it is important to note that a programming language consists of the formal language part, making it recognizable by a computer. But moreover, a programming language needs to have an unambiguous meaning which intends to perform computation. So these two sides, you can also call them the syntax side and the semantics side. So syntax is all about how can we parse, how can we extract from a piece of text by using a computer information that is stored in that text. How can we analyze the text and understand the structure of the program? Now, semantics is a way to describe what the language is supposed to do. So given a program, what does the program mean in terms of the computation that has to be performed by the machine if it starts executing the program? Furthermore, there is a third way of classifying programming languages, namely whether a programming language is useful or useless. Now, of course, the usefulness of a programming language depends on what the user wants. This might also explain to you why over the past years, many new languages are developed, because there is a new environment in which the users want different things. So maybe a new language can satisfy that need better. But moreover, there are useless programming languages, and those are also interesting to study. You could call that the usefulness of a programming language is its significance. So let's get back to concepts of programming languages. Why would you want to study concepts of programming languages? Well, the main reason is that if you study concepts of programming language, it gives you a way to distinguish features between languages and to understand how languages are in some way the same and in other ways different. And this fine distinction between programming language, the finer you can make it, and the better you understand why different programming languages exist, or how you would use it, or how you, what makes the most sense in a given context. Another important aspect for studying concepts of programming languages is that it provides you a tool for learning to learn new programming languages. So, since there are many different programming languages, at some point you could expect to be well versed in the concepts that are shared among all of them, that learning a new language becomes a breeze. Further, there is this notion of conceptual orthogonality. What this means is that to understand different features of programming languages, you can zoom into one feature while forgetting about the rest of the programming language. And then you would call this feature to be orthogonal to the rest. Now, a good designed programming language has many different, let's call it dimensions or orthogonal concepts, such that learning one concept and learning the other concept allows you to combine both and have both features in the programming language. So it is an abstract notion, but we will see during the course very many concrete examples of conceptual orthogonality. So to give you an idea of what you can expect during this course of concepts of programming languages, this course provides you a kaleidoscopic view on the concepts of programming languages. So you get an overview of what is out there, and this overview is focusing not only on the practical side of programming, it also shows you theoretical aspects of programming languages, combining both theory and practice. Some concepts can be explored in a very deep way, and we do not have time to go into the details for all of the concepts involved in this course. So therefore, some concepts will be merely introduced so that you know of the existence of it, but be aware that some concepts are really deep fields of study themselves. So the main purpose of this course is to give you an overview, allowing you to decide what future directions you want to take in further study. So this course is also a little bit divided into theoretical topics and practical topics. The practical topics are best learned by doing. The theoretical topics are best learned by reading and by listening and discussing. So the theoretical topics that will be done during this course are methods to describe language syntax and semantics. But these methods are described, or at least discussed in theory, we will also practice with it. An important theoretical topic is the lambda calculus, and in the next lecture I will explain to you what that is. We will also dive into types and type systems, the notion of bindings and polymorphism. We will look at higher order functions, and these topics may not yet say something to you, but that's expected, eh? Because we will do that during the course. Object orientation and generics, concurrency, and theorem proving. So this gives you an idea of the theoretical topics of this course. Then the practical topics. We will be doing exercises with lexical analysis and parsing. We will do some functional programming. And we will practice with imperative programming. We will do some event-based programming in the terms of a GUI, graphical user interface. And we will do some logic programming as it is, for instance, used in expert systems or in databases. And we will see visual programs. So that then gives you an idea of what to expect. Thank you for watching this video, and hopefully see you soon.